بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم عن أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص عمر بن خطاب رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه رواه إمام المحدثين أبو عبد الله محمد بن إسماعيل بن إبراهيم بن المغيرة بن بر دزبة البخاري الجعفي وأبو الحسين مسلم ابن الحجاج ابن مسلم القشيري النيسابوري في صحيحهما الذين هما أصح الكتب المصنفة In our hadith, it is reported on the authority of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Abu Hafs. Abu, when you say Abu Hafs, father of Hafs, Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar, the son of al-Khattab, radiyallahu anhu, Allah be pleased with him, that he said, Sami'tu, I heard who? The messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ Actions are judged by niyyah. Actions are judged by one's intention. We all know the word niyyah. When I say I'm going to make a niyyah to perform salatul dhuhr, I'm going to make intention. You see? You know the words. It just needs to be activated. So actions are judged by intention, by motives. So each man will have what he intended. Thus, the person whose migration is for Allah or is towards Allah and His Messenger, his migration is to Allah and His Messenger. But he whose migration was for some worldly thing that he might benefit from or gain from, or a woman that he intends to marry, his migration is to that for which he migrated. This hadith is narrated or related by the two imams of the scholars of hadith. And the first one is Imam al-Bukhari, he said his whole name there, and also Imam Muslim in their two sahihs. We heard of the book Sahih al-Bukhari, it's also another book, Sahih al-Muslim, which are the soundest of the compiled hadiths. So firstly, a background into this hadith. This hadith was expressed by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam during a time when a man made hijrah. He made hijrah from Mecca to Medina al-Munawwara. For the sake, for the intention of wanting to marry someone, a certain woman. This hadith in itself is one of the greatest hadith in Islam. According to Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy upon him, this hadith is one third of the knowledge of Islam. And it can be connected or related to 70 topics of the subject of fiqh. So this hadith contains one third of the knowledge of Islam, and it is connected or related to seven topics under the subject of fiqh. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, in relation to the saying, or with reference to the qawl of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, statement said, Islam is based on three fundamental principles. Number one, actions of the heart. Actions of the heart, yani our internal actions. Number two, actions of the limbs, our external actions. And number three, interaction between people, or commonly known as layman's terms, our daily dealings or our mu'amalat. So number one, the actions of the heart, which is internal. Actions of the limbs, which is external, our external actions. And then it is our relations, our interactions between people. Meaning our daily dealings, our mu'amalat with people. And these three principles are captured in this hadith, as well as two other hadith, which inshallah ta'ala we will do in the coming weeks to come. Now, the hadith speaks about intention, speaks about niyyah. Now, niyyah has two meanings. The first meaning is the intention before commencement or before performing an act of ibadah. So the first meaning of niyyah is the intention before performing an ibadah. An example of these are salah, or fasting, or the intention to give zakah, the intention to go for hajj, and so forth. That's the first meaning of niyyah. The second meaning of niyyah is the willingness to perform an action. And the hadith that we are dealing with refers to this, the willingness to perform an action. Now, amongst the lessons that we can learn from this hadith, in this hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lays out for us, or starts with the principle of actions are judged according to their motives, according to their intention. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives us three practical examples of this. And this is one of the methodologies which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used in order to convey the message of Islam. And through these examples, it helps to illustrate the principle so that it is easier for the layman or for the people to understand, in order that they can apply this principle into a similar situation that they might find themselves. Because our deen is a deen of practice. Everything in our deen is, you know, to do things, to practice it, put it into action. This is important. So one of the three examples, or the single, the example is that we first take out here is the one intention is that the person is making hijrah to Allah and to His Messenger. Meaning basically, he's making a migration for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for the sake of His Messenger. So this is one single good intention for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The two lesser important or the inferior intention is, the one is for the migration in order to achieve something, a worldly gain, material benefit. And the second of these is in order that he might want to make intention to make this hijrah in order to marry a particular lady or marriage per se. Another important lesson that we can learn from this hadith is the importance of ikhlas. Ikhlas meaning sincerity. We must be truthful and honest enough with ourselves when it comes to the importance of our ibadah. We should ask ourselves that question, for who am I doing this ibadah? We must be honest and truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this ibadah, this act of worship that we are doing, it is solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whereby there's no other witness to this except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another important thing for the acceptance of deeds, good deeds, ikhlas is important for the acceptance of any good deed that we do. If our amal or our a'mal is void of ikhlas, it is null and void in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a very, very important point that we must not forget. So ikhlas is one of the conditions for the acceptance of good deeds. And number two, that our actions must be done in accordance with the Sharia. Our actions must be done in conformity, in accordance with the Sharia, the Islamic law, and the interdependence of these conditions is being clearly illustrated where? In our Shahada, in our testimony. I'll lay it out to you inshallah ta'ala. When we say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. When we say I bear witness that there is no ilah but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is this ikhlas with which we are saying it, ensuring that all our actions are purely and solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second part is, I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah, is the sunnah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the sunnatul qawliyya, the sunnatul fi'liyya, and the sunnah taqririyya. Right. So the first saying is the same. When we say sayings of the Prophet, when we hear qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is sunnatul qawliyya. When we say sunnatul fi'liyya, These are the actions. So the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, says, we saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I saw Rasulullah sallallahu doing the wudu in this manner. That is fi'liyah. And the sunnah of taqririyah. This is the sunnah of affirmation. An example of the sunnah is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was one day presented with a dab. Now what is a dab? A dab is one of those lizards, those desert lizards. So he was presented to eat from this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not eat from it, but he allowed the Sahaba, meaning he did not say it is haram. He did not say it is makruh. He himself did not eat from it, but he did not say deny the Sahaba from eating from this lizard. This is an affirmation. So he basically, he did not say nay or yay. He did not say yes or no. He just kept quiet and he allowed them to eat. This is affirmation. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we know, is our role model and the best example to follow. And following his sunnah in our ibadah, the akhlaq, ethic and mu'amalat, dealings, ensures that we are acting in accordance with the sharia. We said the ikhlas is important for acceptance of good deeds, and it must be in conformity with the Islamic law or the sharia. Thus, our shahada shows us that the conditions for performing an action and the acceptance for those actions are, number one, it should be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one we worship, and it should be in accordance with the Islamic law or the sharia. Now, someone might ask, Sheikh, how do we achieve ikhlas? How can we attain this ikhlas, this sincerity that is mentioned? The first thing in order to attain this ikhlas is that we must keep away, or we must avoid shirk. And shirk, as we know, its simple form is ascribing partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because this will result in insincerity. Al-Imam al-Harawi said the root cause for insincerity is self-desire. Meaning, we follow our hawa, self-desire. No action should be done on the basis of self-desire. Imam al-Harawi also says that there are seven types of self-desires. Number one, to make oneself appear good in the hearts of others. To make oneself appear good in the heart of others. So this is really insincere. This is following one's ego, one's nafs. Number two, when we want to seek the praise of others, number three, to avoid being blamed by others. Number four, to seek glorification from other people. Number five, to seek the services or the love of others. Number six, to seek the wealth or the property and the money of others. And number seven, to seek the help of others for oneself.
What's the last one?
The last one, to seek the help of others for oneself. One of the seven types of selfishness. Number six is to seek the services.
To seek the money
and wealth of others. Now, there are various ways in order for us to achieve ikhlas. So there are various ways in order for us to be able to attain the ikhlas, the sincerity, and doing the a'mal or the amal solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one is, firstly, we need to increase in righteous or good deeds. Because the more deeds that we do, the closer we are able to draw to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills this, and the more sincere we will become. So very important there, we need to increase our righteous deeds, and the more deeds we do, through our good deeds, we will draw closer to Allah, and with that, we will start, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, increase our sincerity. Number two, seeking of knowledge. Seeking of knowledge. Prior for us to do any good deed, we should seek ilm. Our actions and deeds should be based on knowledge to ensure that these deeds are done and performed in accordance with the Sharia, or the Islamic law. Avoidance of giving false impressions. This is number three. We should not make others believe that an action is good if it isn't. That's why it comes to the ilm part. Again, avoidance of giving false impressions, and we should not make others, or tell others, or inform others, make others believe that this is something good, when in actual fact maybe it isn't good. Allah. And checking of the intention. What is your intention? What is my intention? What is our intention? Your sister, which one is it? We should not make others believe that an action is good when that action isn't good. Okay? And next, we should check our intention. Why are we doing something? Why am I doing this? Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, said, before you do anything, you should ask yourself, or first you should check, what is your niyyah? What is your intention before you do anything? Ask yourself before performing action, is this deed, is this amal, is this a'mal for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If your answer is yes, it's got ikhlas. If it is no, or you're not sure, then you must recheck. Recheck your niyyah. There are three asbab, or three reasons that our actions may be defective. So three reasons when our deeds, our actions may be defective in some form. Number one, being conscious of being conscious that others are observing our actions. This will make it defective. Number two, when we seek a reward or any benefit for the action that we are doing. And thirdly, when we are satisfied with this action. Being satisfied with the action. So maybe we tell someone, whatever it may be. Now we shall see a few examples of how we can obtain ikhlas. Number one, we're going back to where we said we shouldn't be proud of ourselves. An example here is, we should not be proud of ourselves and we think that we are better than others. An example of this is, we reach the masjid and mashallah, we get a chance to stand in the first saf and we come early for Salatul Jama'ah. And sometimes we even arrive before the imam. So we should praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremostly for enabling us to go to the masjid and for enabling us to perform the salah without any difficulties or any hindrances or disturbances. So we should not be proud of ourselves and think that we are better than others if we've reached the masjid early, for example, and we are getting to the first saf and we've come before the imam and now we think, I'm first here, I'm that, this, whatever. We should just thank Allah and praise Him for first having afforded us the opportunity to perform a salah in jama'ah and without any difficulties. Number two, after every salah, so we pray five times, mashallah, each day. We should tell ourselves that we could have performed our salah in a better manner. And we should tell ourselves, perhaps we neglected some things in the salah, that the next salah coming, we are going to do even better. We're going to improve on the shortcomings that happened in the previous salah. So when we are doing our salah, after our salah, we must reflect upon the salah that we just did. Did I recite my takbirat al-ihram properly? Did I recite my surah al-fatiha properly? Was I concentrating in my salah? Or did I drift off and think about a million different things that I've still had to do and go to places, whatever it might be? Did I stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humbly enough? Did I make my adhkar after the salah? Did I make dua after the salah? Or was it just hit and run after the imam said, I just made salam and I got up and off I went without pondering for that second, for that moment, for that 5 minutes about the salah and so forth and so forth. Another question that might come up when we ask ourselves, what if our niyyah, our intention changes whilst we are performing an action, an act of ibadah? What happens? What do we do now? So the question is, what if our niyyah changes whilst we are performing an action? According to the ulama, Ibn Rajab says, according to the ulama, the scholars, if the niyyah at the end of the action matches the niyyah at the beginning, meaning you're doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then any changes in the middle of performing the action will be forgiven. So the niyyah, I made the niyyah at the beginning, and at the end of the action, my niyyah is still the same. Anything in between, the action will be forgiven. Or it will not basically matter for that case. However, if the niyyah at the end does not match the niyyah at the beginning, implying we perform the action not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then repentance must be made. Tawbah must be made. You see how important that niyyah is that we make? Because on this niyyah, we were judged. Actions are judged according to one's intention. So that's how important it is. Now there are four things which contradicts with ikhlas, or contradicts ikhlas. Number one, ma'siyah, sinning, evil deeds. Committing them will weaken your ikhlas. Number two, shirk, ascribing partners, associating others with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first one, ma'siyah, committing sins. These will decrease. Number two, shirk. Number three, riya. Riya, when you do things not for the sake of Allah, for the sake of people. This is riya. Intending to do an ibadah with the niya of showing off unto others. And the fourth thing that will contradict one's ikhlas is nifaq. And what is nifaq? Nifaq is hypocrisy. So there are certain ahkam based on this hadith. The scholars have derived some ahkam amongst which are when anyone swears by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying, and this you might have heard very commonly amongst the Arabs, they always like to say, wallahi, wallahi this, wallahi that. Like to say it. So they're swearing and they say, wallahi. They're saying, in the name of Allah. But if the intention is not actually to swear by the name of Allah, this is now considered pointless. But in many instances, the swearing in Allah's name is done simply out of habit. It just kind of rolls from their tongue, as they say. It's like second nature to them, or it's in the culture, or to that effect. A Muslim, a true Muslim, should do his utmost and best to minimize this. Another ruling law that's taken, ahkam hukum is taken from this hadith, is when a person takes an oath. So he takes the oath, or is requested to give an oath, he is judged by his intention when he gives this oath. So the first one, not swearing in the name of Allah, it should not be done in jest, jokingly, should minimize it. Good. Secondly, when one is requested to give an oath, by taking this oath, you will be judged according to your intention of how you have given this oath. Now also there can be a combination of intentions between performing an ibadah and teaching others. How? Meaning we can perform an act of ibadah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and through this act of ibadah, we can also be teaching others. How? I'll give an example. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performed the Hajj he had done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he was also teaching the Sahaba how to perform the Hajj. So there is a combination of intention between performing an ibadah for the sake of Allah and also being able to teach other people. Another example, another ruling that can be taken, a man may go through the process of talaq. So he might be going through the process of talaqing his wife, verbally, in or outside the court. In order for this talaq to be valid, it will depend on his intention. Okay? A man, maybe out of anger, or something, and he snapped on his wife and he says, anti talaq. This talaq will only be valid if we go back to his intention. Because he could have said this at the moment of extreme anger. Or maybe he had lost his mind for that moment. So, the hukum is this talaq valid or not valid? So we will ask this person, what was your intention when you had said to your wife, you are divorced? If he says, my intention was to divorce her, that talaq will now count as a talaq. But if he said, I was in a fit of anger at that moment, or I did not mean it, my intention was not to give her a divorce, he will be judged according to his intention. And the last one, what could be seen as ghibah, backbiting, talking bad about a person behind his or her back, even though these are factual, could simply be a joke or a dua, a supplication. If someone talks bad about someone else, it is at the end of the day his intention which determines whether it is ghibah or not. So when you are talking about someone, you've got to be very, very careful. If you're talking about someone, there's a hadith that relates, even if this thing about the person is true, you are backbiting him. That's the one narration of the hadith. But also here, it's very important, we should protect our tongues from just talking willy-nilly, just anything, or about anyone. Afdal, abstain. Do not say anything. Because you do not know. Unknowingly, you might be committing an act, a ma'asiyah of backbiting. And it falls upon you. And it counts as a, you have backbited, eating the flesh of your Muslim brother. So in conclusion, my brothers and sisters in Islam, our actions are determined by our niyyah, by our intention, whether It could be a good action, if you intend it, or a bad action. The important thing is that we should always check our niyyah. This is very important. And we must ensure that the action that we are doing, which concerns our ibadah and so forth, this is done for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is in conformity with the Islamic law or the Sharia. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding of, number one, the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding of this beautiful deen that we have, that we have been blessed with, the beautiful deen of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us our iman and our taqwa. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that before we leave this dunya, that the kalima shahada will make it easy for us to pronounce the kalima shahada of la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding of the hadith. This evening's hadith, the hadith that we use in the past, the verses of the Quran that we use in the past, and that we adapt at the end of the day, we apply this. Because whatever we learn, of qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa qala Allah ta'ala azza wa jal, we need to comprehend those verses, and we need to understand those hadith. And it's important that we try and we put these into practice in our daily lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us firmness, ithbat on the sirat al-mustaqim, on the rightly guided way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us our dua, and that dua is that we are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannatul Firdaus. We will be amongst the Anbiya alayhim salatu wa salam, and the Shuhada, and the Salihin, and the Sadiqeen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us this, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness in this dunya as well as in the Akhirah. Bisirri al-Fatiha. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ربنا آمنا بما أنزلت واتبعنا الرسول فاكتبنا مع الشاهدين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وأدخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى يا رب العالمين اللهم إنا نسألك إيمانا كاملا ويقينا صادقا وقلبا خاشعا ولسانا ذاكرا ورزقا حلالا طيبا وتوبة نصوحا وتوبة قبل الموت وراحة بعد الموت ومغفرة ورحمة بعد الموت والعفو عند الحساب والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة ونعيمها وما يقربنا إليها من قول أو عمل ونعوذ بك من النار ونعوذ بك من ونعوذ بك من النار وما يقربنا إليها من قول أو عمل اللهم إنا نسألك الخير كله عاجله وآجله ما علمنا منه وما لم نعلم ونعوذ بك من الشر كله عاجله وعاجله ما علمنا منه وما لم نعلم اللهم اغفر لنا اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولأم ولأزواجنا ولأولادنا ولمشايخنا ولإخواننا ولأخواتنا ولجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم اغفر لأهل القبور من المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات ارفع لهم الدرجات وكفر عنهم السيئات يا رب العالمين اللهم ربنا زدنا علما وارزقنا فهما اللهم ربنا زدنا علما وارزقنا فهما اللهم ارزقنا اللهم زدنا علما وارزقنا فهما اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وأطراف النهار واجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين قال الله تعالى مخبرا وآمرا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وأصحابه وبارك وسلم اللهم افتح لنا بالخير واختم لنا بالخير واجعل عواقب أمورنا بالخير بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون دعواهم فيها سبحانك اللهم وتحيتهم فيها سلام وآخر دعواهم أن الحمد لله رب العالمين ربنا الله إن شاء الله